month of Mary. I would like to welcome most especially His Excellency Bishop's presence today. We're very thankful. Bishop Cotta will be giving the homily today. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank in a special way His Excellency Bishop Jaime Soto for his support, his prayers, which he has promised as well. I would like to thank Reverend Father Michael O'Reilly, the Cathedral Director, Father Blaise Berg, who is with us today, the Vicar of Clergy, the Cathedral staff, which is always very helpful to us, very kind. Many people who might be thanked, probably should be thanked, in helping to bring about this procession and Mass today. I would mention most especially the Altar Guild of St. Stephen's, who are here in force today, the choir members and choristers of St. Stephen's, Mr. Michael Sultan, who directs everything, puts it all together, does so very much, and so many others, once again, too numerous to mention, and not that anyone's looking to be mentioned, but we certainly do appreciate all the effort that has gone in to making this day beautiful for our Blessed Mother. Just a quick instruction on receiving Holy Communion. For those of you who may not be familiar with the traditional Mass, kneelers will be set up in front of the altar area. Communion is received kneeling, unless you have difficulty kneeling, of course. And communion is only received on the tongue. The priest will say a little prayer. May the body of Christ guard your soul into everlasting life. He makes the sign of the cross with the host. The priest himself says amen. You don't have to say anything, simply put out your tongue, and the priest places the host on it. And thank you for your attention.
Good morning, everyone. It is truly a pleasure to be here at Blessed Sacrament, the Cathedral, to celebrate and to be present at this great event, the 6th annual Marian procession, Mass, and coronation of our Blessed Mother. To have a great devotion to Our Lady is such a fundamental thing in our lives as Catholics and as Christians, to uphold this woman who gave her complete yes to God, setting the stage and setting an example for us to continue to give our daily yeses to her son, Jesus. This first Saturday is traditionally a time in which we come before Our Lady and acknowledge the graces that we receive through her Immaculate Heart, a great devotion in the Church, the first Saturday devotions. We see the wonderful month, as Father John mentioned, of May, which is a time in which we acknowledge motherhood. We acknowledge new life in the season of spring. We acknowledge the apparition of Our Lady in Fatima, where she encourages devotion to her Immaculate Heart and to pray for peace in a troubled world that continues to be troubled, not only in 1917, but in 2014, maybe even more so. We acknowledge that first apparition in which she laid out a peace plan for humanity and an ongoing call to conversion through penance and prayer, allowing the Spirit of God to move our hearts and minds to love God more and our neighbor as ourselves. It is truly in Fatima a time of procession and pilgrimage whenever you go there, whenever you set foot on that sacred space within the santuario, the sanctuary, the plaza, whatever you want to call it, but the sacred space at the covaderia, there is always a procession involved in the evening. be it maybe a Eucharistic procession, but without doubt a Marian procession during the evenings, candle lit. Today, many of you participated in a procession as you acknowledged this journey of life. It's a very symbolic gesture on our part as Catholics as we go through the community, not only in procession, but giving witness to our love for Our Lady, the Mother of our Savior and the Redeemer of humanity. So it isn't just procession, it's also a sign of witness to the world as we process to encounter Jesus here in the Eucharist, here in the celebration of this Mass, coming into a very personal contact as we receive him in Holy Communion today, the Son of Mary. Fatima was and continues to be a great center of Eucharistic devotion, as part of that was the revelation of Our Lady to the three children, and as she continued to upheld throughout the celebrations that take place there, there's always ongoing liturgies, Mass. There are Eucharistic processions, there's the blessing of the sick, there's benediction. And as the angel of Portugal told the three children, it was part of their preparation to come to know and to believe and to hope in Christ's presence in the Eucharist. It prepared them for what was coming in the visitation of Our Lady, just as the Eucharist prepares us for everyday life, for the difficulties of life, for the joys of life, for the big decisions of life. Jesus is there, the Son of Mary, to enlighten our minds, to give us courage, to give us the grace of perseverance, a grace of gift of faith, hope, and love that we desperately need to be the witnesses of Jesus in the world today. In this procession of today, in the procession, be it in Lourdes, or be it in Fatima, or be it in Mexico City, wherever there are sanctuaries of Our Lady and this beautiful basilicas, it's to never forget that Our Lady journeys with us. She's constantly present to us. We need to reach out to her. We need to invite her to be part of our journey as we prepare for the coming of Christ, for the end of our lives, to enter the New Jerusalem. Are we inviting her into our lives? Are we on this journey, this procession, this ongoing pilgrimage of ongoing conversion in our personal lives? Are we listening to the promptings of the Holy Spirit in our life when we need to repent, when we need to let go, when we need to detach for the sake of a greater love of God in our lives and our neighbor? And in that journey, as the journey of today in the procession, it wasn't a time of silence, but it was a time of prayer, praying the gift of the rosary that Our Lady, the Immaculate One, encouraged us to hang on to and to pray and to reflect upon the mysteries of our faith, the mysteries of salvation, which is part of the devotion to the Immaculate Heart of Mary, spending time in quiet, reflecting upon the joyful mysteries, the sorrowful, glorious mysteries, the mysteries of light, the luminous mysteries, and how that allows us to be pulled in and drawn into a greater relationship with Christ as we reflect on what he did for us and what Our Lady has done for us in being obedient to the Father as her Son. She leads us in procession to her Son. Her Son leads us to God the Father, and we need to cooperate then with the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit within our lives on this journey of life, this journey of pilgrimage. As we come to the liturgy of God's holy word today, we come across maybe one of the shortest gospels that we have. But it's a very powerful gospel because it involves Our Lady with her Son to the very end. We see the scene of Mary at the foot of the cross, that pilgrimage to Mount Calvary, that procession to Mount Calvary, she at the foot of the cross of execution of her son. And I came across a very beautiful reflection saying that all along, the Son of God, Jesus, is emptying himself out of love for us. This kenosis of Jesus and the kenosis of Mary at the foot of the cross was probably the greatest kenosis for her and for him. It was like the last thing he had to let go of, to offer, which was his mother. When he told St. John, "Behold your mother," giving her to him and to us, when she had accompanied him throughout, the last bit of abandoning and allowing all to be given up to God the Father. And she, in her kenosis, letting go of her son to fulfill the plan of God the Father. Obedient, selfless, emptying herself so that we might be saved. Mary's kenosis at the foot of the cross and saying, "Behold your son, behold your children," disconnecting Jesus, emptying himself, Mary emptying herself, so that the plan of God may be fulfilled. And it's in this beautiful season of Easter that we acknowledge the victory over that obedience and that self-emptying with the resurrection of Jesus. And it's with the resurrection of Jesus and this glorification of Mary, the Immaculate Heart, that we crown the image of Our Lady, victorious in her emptying of herself, in her personal suffering, in union with her Son, as we acknowledge the risen Christ in our midst today, as we acknowledge it symbolically in the Easter candle, very prominent, so we never forget the victory of Jesus' emptying of himself out of love for us. May today's crowning of Our Lady, which will be part of our celebration today, remind us of the crown promised to us as we strive to be faithful to the call, faithful and persevering on the journey, the profession, the procession, from here to eternal life. We ask Our Lady's blessing today as we entrust our lives, we consecrate our minds, our hearts, our souls, our whole being, to her Immaculate Heart. And we offer this world, entrusting it to her. We pray especially in a very special way for the peace that is needed in Ukraine and in the Middle East. We pray for the change of hearts of all men and women. Our Lady, Queen of Peace, pray for us. Our Lady, Queen of Heaven and Earth, pray for us. Our Lady, Queen of the Most Holy Rosary, pray for us. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Thank you. Oh, God.